DDR5 RAM is coming, so if you've been thinking about building a new PC anytime soon, you're gonna have to make a decision. Should you wait and hold out for DDR5, or just go with DDR4? And you will have to decide, because they are not backwards compatible. So in this video, I'm gonna try and give you all the information you'll possibly need about making a decision, including what's the differences between DDR5 and DDR4, of course, and when you can expect DDR5 to come out. So let's get into all the major differences between DDR5 and DDR4. The first difference is memory bandwidth. This is basically how fast data can be retrieved from or put onto the memory stick. It's kind of a big deal. Now, with the maximum standard specifications, DDR4 has a maximum bandwidth of up to 3.2 gigabits per second per pin. With DDR5 though, the maximum spec has up to 6.4 gigabits per second per pin, although at first it'll probably be around 4.8 gigabits per second. So it's still a 50% increase, much better, but eventually as RAM improves, it'll get up to 6.4, double this bandwidth. Now I mentioned the bandwidth per pin. DDR4 and DDR5 have the same number of data pins, so that's not gonna make a difference here. However, the frequency of the memory is going to make a major difference. That's the reason for the difference in memory bandwidth between the two. The standard DDR4 spec has a frequency range of between 1600 megahertz and 3200 megahertz, whereas the DDR5 spec is double that, between 3200 megahertz and 6400 megahertz. But the eventual maximum number will probably be even higher than that. I mean, even with DDR4, the maximum spec is just up to 3200 megahertz. But you may see, if you go on Newegg or something like that, you can see RAM up to about 5000 megahertz right now. That's probably down to overclocking. So technically, 3.2 gigahertz is the max standard spec for DDR4, but of course it is higher, so we'll probably see much higher than the 6.4 per pin on DDR5. In fact, I've seen talk of about up to 8400 megahertz for DDR5. But the main takeaway from all this is DDR5 will be capable of higher frequencies and therefore higher memory bandwidth overall. All right, the next difference between DDR4 and DDR5 is the power management structure. So with DDR4, all the power management of the RAM slot is going to be done on the motherboard itself. Whereas on DDR5, it's going to have an actual chip called a PMIC, power management integrated circuit, on the chip itself. Each individual chip will be able to manage its own individual power. So theoretically, this should mean that the RAM is going to be more power efficient, because for example, I guess if a individual RAM DIMM module requires more power at a certain moment, it will be able to get that power without having to increase the power to all the RAM at once. At least that is my understanding of it. And also, I'm not 100% sure how this will affect overclocking RAM. You can do that right now through your BIOS on your motherboard. Not sure if you won't be able to do that or you will. We'll have to see. The next major difference between the two generations is the channel architecture. Now, you may know that you can get like dual channel RAM, quad channel RAM with different slots in the motherboard. This basically just makes it so the CPU can go out and access different pieces of data within each channel, whereas if there's just one channel, the CPU can basically only get one piece of data at a time. It's kind of like having multiple cores in a CPU. You can do multiple stuff at once as opposed to just one at a time. Now, each DDR4 module has just one channel per stick, and it's made up of 72 bits total. That's 64 data bits and then 8 bits for error correcting. With DDR5, however, each RAM module or stick has two channels. Each of those channels is a 40-bit bus, meaning it's going to have 32 bits of data pins and then 8 for error correcting pins. So effectively, it's the same amount of data pins between DDR4 and DDR5 on each stick. It's 64 for both. However, with DDR5, you're gonna have two channels instead of just one. Now, like I said, DDR4 already does support multiple channels. However, with DDR5, you can have two channels on each individual stick, which means if there's two different pieces of data, one in each channel that the CPU wants to access in different parts, it can do both of those without having to wait for one or the other. So each individual RAM stick should be a lot more efficient, and I assume this means we're gonna be able to get a lot more potential channels in DDR5. All right, now the next big difference between DDR5 and 4 is the so-called burst length. This one is gonna be a little bit technical, but I will try and explain it as best I can, as simply as I can, because it is pretty important. So DDR4 has a burst length of 8, whereas DDR5 has a burst length of 16. what does that mean? This did take a little bit of research on my part. I'm not a super expert on this, obviously. I could be a little bit off in some parts, but this is my understanding. Hopefully it should be helpful. So if you were to zoom all the way into a stick of RAM, you would see that the data is stored in arrays, which are just groups of rows and columns with each combination of the two having a bit. When a certain piece of data in the form of a bit needs to be retrieved from the RAM will first activate a row, which basically prepares it to be read. After a certain row is activated or opened, then one bit from each row can be read from all the arrays simultaneously. And then all of that data gets put into the output buffer to be sent to the CPU or whatever. However, this process of opening and activating a row is actually relatively slow. So if you've ever looked at RAM timings, the TRCD is actually how long it takes to open a row. You've seen that number before. And if there's a different row already open, it's going to take even longer because that row must be closed first, and that amount of time is the TRP. So instead of doing this every single time you have to read one single bit, what the RAM can do is, because that row is already activated for a short amount of time, it can actually go ahead and read multiple columns within that row back to back. So if there's more data in that row that needs to be read, it's gonna be way faster, way more efficient. And the maximum number of bits the RAM can read from a row while it's open before needing to reopen it is called the burst length, because it takes a burst of data at once instead of just getting each bit one at a time. So basically, while DDR5 is gonna likely have very similar timings and latency numbers as DDR4, because it's gonna have a longer burst length in this case, it means that in more situations, it'll be able to read more data without having to have those delays happen as frequently, meaning that overall, it's just gonna be able to access faster speed. All right, now the final big difference between DDR4 and 5 is the maximum capacity. This is a pretty fun one because DDR5 has up to 4 times the maximum density of data as DDR4. Specifically, DDR4 has up to 16 gigabits of data per die, which is each individual little memory chip. However, RAM manufacturers can actually put multiple of these dies on each side of the RAM stick. So this is called stacking. Typically, they can put about 8 of these on each side, and then they can do it on both sides. This is called dual rank. When you multiply all these together, you get a grand total of 256 gigabits, which is 32 gigabytes as the maximum amount of RAM you're gonna be able to fit on one stick of RAM for DDR4. And that is probably consistent with what you'd see if you tried to go out and buy a big stick of RAM. However, with DDR5, you can have up to 64 gigabits of data per die. So again, when you multiply all that out, 64 gigabits times 8 on each side, times 2 sides, and then you convert to gigabytes, you get 128 gigabytes maximum per stick. However, keep in mind, it's gonna take time for the manufacturing process to build up to that maximum density. So at first, when DDR5 first comes out, you're probably gonna still see a maximum individual stick at about 32 gigabytes, and then it'll grow over time. All right, so now that you know the differences between the two generations, you might be wondering, well, when can I actually get this? I'm sold, I wanna get it right now. Well, hold on there. Before we jump into making that decision though, I do wanna thank the sponsor of this video, Private Internet Access. Private Internet Access is a VPN service that allows you to protect your internet connection from prying eyes of all kinds, even from your internet service provider. And like I've said before, I am a personal subscriber of PIA. You can see my literal billing history here going back to 2014. To use it, you simply install the VPN software and choose any of the servers across many different countries. The same goes with the mobile apps. You simply toggle it on and you're good. And this is especially important on your phone, where you're more likely to be using public Wi-Fi hotspots that might not be safe. And yes, it is available on all desktop and mobile platforms, and that includes as browser extensions for Chrome, Firefox, and Opera. There's also plenty of other additional features, like the VPN kill switch to prevent accidentally revealing your connection, and so-called PIA Mace, which can block trackers, malware, and more. And there's also advanced features like choosing the specific protocol, DNS traffic, and more if you want to get into that. And it also does support peer-to-peer connections such as for BitTorrent. And of course, very importantly, Private Internet Access does not keep logs of any kind. And actually, just for you guys watching this video, there's a special deal you can get by going to privateinternetaccess.com/TheoJoe. That link is also in the description, where you can get up to 77% off the 2-year plan, which ends up being around $2.59 a month. Not much at all. So again, be sure to check that link right in the description. And so, having said all that, let's continue. Right now, you already do see DDR5. It exists, but right now you can basically only see it in like high-end smartphones. For example, the Samsung Galaxy S20, Samsung makes their own RAM, so they can integrate it into their phones really easily. They're making the chips too. Now, RAM that's for actual computers and servers, that's probably not gonna be expected to roll out until around 2021. But just because RAM manufacturers start making DDR5 RAM doesn't mean you're gonna actually necessarily be able to use it in your PC. And that's because we need to wait for AMD and Intel to actually make CPUs and chipsets and motherboards that actually will support DDR5. With AMD, some leaked internal memos reportedly suggest that they are planning to support DDR5 and USB 4.0 in 2022. And that's apparently when their next gen Zen 4 microarchitecture is released. And that is kind of a long ways off because as of making this video, their Zen 3 architecture just came out. With Intel, some reported leaks show that it's likely that their 12th generation Alder Lake codename CPUs will support DDR5. But again, this could take a while because even their 11th gen Rocket Lake CPUs are not even out yet. So it's possible that the Alder Lake will be around the second half of 2021. So looking at all this, it seems like the earliest you could possibly get a DDR5 computer is around the end of 2021, and that's only if Alder Lake from Intel comes out by then. But if they don't and it's a little bit later, it'll probably come around the same time as AMD in 2022. So it's now decision time. If you've been thinking about getting a new PC, should you wait for DDR5 or not? Well, there's a few things you need to consider. First of all, when DDR5 first comes out, the difference between DDR4 and DDR5 is not gonna be as big. That's because RAM manufacturers get better at producing better RAM over time. I mean, DDR4 right now is way better than it used to be when it first came out. Yes, DDR5 will still be significantly better than DDR4, but the price will be much more expensive at first with a smaller difference than down the line where DDR5 becomes more affordable and actually improves. The next thing you need to consider is how often you intend to upgrade to a new PC. If you're like me, then I prefer to just go all out, get the best specs, get everything, and then keep it for a very long time. My computer right now is about 5 years old, which for a computer is pretty darn old, but over time, I do upgrade a little bit of the components inside, like the GPU, I'll upgrade some of the RAM when better stuff comes out, and that sort of thing. So I would probably personally prefer to get something that's more future-proof that I can upgrade for longer. And if I built a DDR4 computer, well, DDR4 is probably getting close to as good as it's gonna get at this point, not much gonna be able to be upgraded down the line. Whereas DDR5, it's going to improve. The third big thing you need to consider is how badly you want or need to upgrade your computer right now. If you have been planning and really wanna build a computer right at this moment, you're probably fine doing just that. DDR5 is at least a year out from the making of this video, and it's gonna be even longer before it really comes down in price and reaches its full potential. On the other hand, if you're someone who's been thinking, I kinda wanna upgrade my computer eventually, maybe sometime in the next year, in my opinion, it would be better for you to just wait. You can use all that extra time to potentially budget and save up a bunch more money, and then buy a bigger and better one anyway when you are ready to get it. For me personally, I am probably just gonna wait for DDR5. I did say that my computer is getting pretty old. It does struggle sometimes. However, I would much more value just having a computer that I can upgrade for a very, very long time and continue using for that long. But that's also because I do use my computer for very heavy tasks as a workstation, like video editing. So I tend to buy the highest end components, the most powerful stuff. It's pretty expensive. I don't want to be doing that very often. For most people though, the difference between DDR4 and DDR5 is not even going to necessarily be very noticeable. Even if you're a gamer, most of the time the bottleneck is going to be in the CPU and the GPU. The RAM is probably not going to be the bottleneck on your computer, so it's not going to really make a difference. It's probably better for you to just get a good GPU, good CPU, and decent RAM, and if you can get cheaper DDR4 RAM that's really good, then that'll give you more money to put on other components. So with all that information, hopefully now you can make a better decision on whether you want to wait for a new computer or get one now if you've been thinking about it. Again, I want to thank Private Internet Access for sponsoring this video. Be sure to go to privateinternetaccess.com/TheoJoe, links also in the description, so you can get that heavily discounted deal. If you guys want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is one where I went over a bunch of different tips that you should be doing for computer maintenance every single month to keep your computer running much longer so you can keep it much longer like I do. So I'll put that link right here. You can just click on that. So thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next video.